coming up on Need to Know. A Rochester nun is heading to the UN to share her experiences during the civil rights movement. We'll learn more about this Sister of Selma, as she's called, and why Congressman John Lewis applauded the work of her and her fellow sisters on Bloody Sunday. Also on the show, a mission is underway to strengthen the number of individuals with disabilities heading to the polls. A look at this powerful voting bloc and the issues they say can no longer be overlooked by elected officials. And why a local library is viewed as the family room of one city neighborhood. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know. Years ago, a number of Catholic nuns from the Sisters of St. Joseph of Rochester were missioned in Selma, Alabama. Their work in Selma actually began in 1940, and 75 years later, that work in the South continues. I recently sat down with Sister Barbara Lum of Rochester, who served in Selma. She'll be heading to the UN this spring to share her experiences in Alabama before and after Bloody Sunday. She explains to me what we have yet to fully learn from Selma. Barbara, when you think back on Selma more than 50 years ago, because I understood you were serving there in the late 1950s, and you were actually a nursing instructor and a director of nursing service at Good Samaritan Hospital, is that right?
Yes.
So
yes.
When you think back, what very thoughts come to mind looking back on your experience there?
Well, I think realizing in hindsight that we were living through a very important part of our history with some very courageous people. And that's all hindsight, though. It's not what I was thinking when I was there. I loved the work. I loved being a nurse. And I loved the people that I worked with. We were the only hospital in 9 counties, Good Samaritan Hospital, that served blacks, which meant that a lot of people drove past other hospitals in order to get to one that would serve them because they were black. And so that was a very sobering realization. Leading up to Bloody Sunday, Jimmie Lee Jackson was a civil rights, he was very active in the civil rights movement. He lived in Marion, Alabama, and there was a night march in Marion, and it was attacked by sheriff's posses and state troopers. Jimmie Lee Jackson took his grandfather and his mother into a little cafe to protect them. And I heard this story from many people. It was told many times. And he was trying to protect them, and the state trooper came in and shot him and killed him. He didn't die immediately. He was brought to Good Samaritan Hospital and died 8 days later. But during that time, when I would make rounds in the hospital, he always took my hand and said, "Sister, don't you think this is a high price to pay for freedom?" And indeed, I do.
I want to look at that day, Bloody Sunday, mm-hmm. March 7th, 1965. Obviously, you didn't wake up that morning having any clue as to what would unfold in that during that day. What do you remember? Is there a story in particular that stands out to you from that day at the hospital?
Now, Congressman from Georgia, Representative John Lewis, was a leader of the march, so he was a target, and they had beaten him seriously. He was admitted to our hospital. I believe he was unconscious at the time. We never had a conversation until last May, when he was the speaker at Rochester Educational Opportunity graduation, and that was a wonderful meeting. But I never spoke with him that day. One of our sisters formed a triage, so the people that needed sutures were coming into our very small emergency room, and the people who had other needs were going, being shepherded down to the dining room. The sisters who taught school were registering people. Everybody was on deck, plus our whole staff. The day staff stayed on. It got to be around 3 in the afternoon. The evening staff came and just was at the ready, and the night staff came. And I remember walking out of the emergency room for some reason for a minute and seeing that the entire night staff was lined up against the wall in uniform, just ready to serve in whatever way. So we were certainly busy. I think we were not overwhelmed. It felt overwhelming, but I think we were not overwhelmed with it. I think we had some sense of organizing, and everybody had a sense of being there to assist.
I want to go back to Congressman John Lewis, because you mentioned, as you said, you saw him last spring here in Rochester, and he shared some words that I'd like to read. And he said, "Thank you to Sister Barbara and all the Sisters of St. Joseph. Thank you for what you did on March 7th, 1965, and before and after. Thank you for treating us so well. I was wounded, hit in the head, and thought I was going to die. I thought to myself, how can President Johnson send more troops to Vietnam, but not send troops to Selma to protect us? The next thing I knew, I was at Good Samaritan Hospital. You took care of a lot of people that day, and I've been wanting to come here for a long time and say thank you. Without you, I don't know what would have happened to us."
And I don't either. I don't either, because we had people who died on the way to Good Samaritan because they weren't treated, you know, somewhere earlier. So that was very sad. I'm not sure what would have happened. There were two other hospitals that treated whites, and whether they would have just risen to the emergency occasion, they weren't tested, so I don't know. Yeah.
You and the Sisters of St. Joseph of Rochester, among other sisters from around the country who were in Selma, you were featured in the documentary, The Sisters of Selma. And it was about some of the untold stories of the contributions all of you made to history. And I want to know, how do you believe that day, Bloody Sunday, and the events of March 7th, and also your experience based and mission in Selma, how do you think that impacted your journey and your life?
Well, I remember that people died for the right to vote. So it's a very serious right to me. And I feel very sad that so many people don't take that as a serious obligation and right to vote, to be an informed voter. I think the whole experience of working with people who were of another, in a sense, culture and race from me was a very broadening, enlightening experience that has stayed with me my whole life.
You returned to Selma earlier in March for the 50th anniversary. What was that experience like?
It was a wonderful homecoming. I saw a few people who are, believe it or not, still around after these 50 years, and had some nice visits with them.
Did you join them on that march?
That was one of the high points, was walking across. On Sunday, we walked across the bridge with these 70,000 people. So that was quite wonderful. And just thinking about what had happened so many years ago on the bridge was sobering. But the spirit of the people walking, for all that crowdedness, people were polite, they were caring, it was more a festive atmosphere in the very best kind of way.
President Barack Obama said during his speech on the anniversary of Bloody Sunday, "First and foremost, we have to recognize that one day's commemoration, no matter how special, is not enough. If Selma taught us anything, it's that our work is never done." I want to know, you have a unique perspective from that time in history. And what work, in your opinion, is unfinished and still needs to be done?
I think our respect for people who are different from us, I mean, from one another, all of us, anyone who is different in their beliefs, their race, whatever, their religion, that we need to learn to respect one another to really hold one another in reverence and not jump to immediate conclusions that we know all about somebody else without finding out. There's a lot of work to be done, a lot of work, but I think maybe it begins with that, getting to know people one-on-one.
Thank you so much for your time, and you will be speaking at the UN on a panel about your experiences in Selma, so we wish you well with that. Thank you for your time.
Yes, thank you very much.
To learn more about the experiences of the Sisters of St. Joseph of Rochester when they return to Selma this month, go to keepingupwithalabama.blogspot.com. Well, this week, the first hat flew into the political ring as Ted Cruz became the first major candidate to announce his 2016 presidential bid. And as the eyes of the country wait to see who's next, there is a sobering statistic elected officials should be aware of. When it comes to voter turnout on Election Day, studies have found there's a major gap between individuals with and without disabilities. There are at least 35 million voting-age people with disabilities in the U.S. However, only 15 million voted in the last presidential election. The Center for Disability Rights, an advocacy group in Rochester, has been working throughout the state to help bridge that gap in New York. Joining me from CDR to discuss this issue and the progress of their work is Stephanie Woodward, Director of Advocacy, and Pooled Trust Advocate Justin Young. And it's great to have both of you here. Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
So let's jump right in and look into what accounts for this gap, why less than half the voting age of people with disabilities are not heading to the polls. And a 2013 study out of Rutgers and Syracuse University found that economic and social resources, that they do play a pivotal role. What was interesting was there was no gap in voter turnout between employed people with and with disabilities. So could you help our viewers understand what else could possibly be contributing to the gap?
Well, there's a lot of things that contribute to the gap. One of the major things societally, we tell people with disabilities that their voice doesn't matter as much. We often have this stigma in society that people with disabilities don't have much to say. They sit over there and have this idea that it's a very segregated society where people with disabilities are just over there. So if you're told every day that you don't matter, you start to feel like your vote won't matter. In other ways, we create barriers to voting. Some voting places, despite laws that require accessibility, are still inaccessible. Some ballot machines that are supposed to be accessible aren't accessible. This year, New York again has allowed inaccessible voting machines to be used in local elections, for such as school elections, machines that people with physical disabilities who don't have the stamina to pull on a lever, or machines that people with visual disabilities can't use. So we're creating barriers.
Mm-hmm. Well, in the spring of 2013, the Center for Disability Rights launched the New York Disability Vote Network. And the goal was to create this database of voters with disabilities and also those who support disability rights. And just taking everything into consideration that you just mentioned, Stephanie, the reasons why the voter turnout for this voting block is low, how does the Disability Vote Network change that? I mean, how is this different, and how is this really working to mobilize and to get more people to the polls?
Well, we have a number of initiatives with this. On one side, we're working with the New York State Board of Elections on how they could be more welcoming of people with disabilities so that we can vote. Because quite frankly, disability issues aren't going to change if we can't even get to the polls to vote for the right person, change them for us. But we have representatives going out in the community and letting people know your vote actually does count. And that piece of empowerment really does make a difference. If you just have one person with a disability looking at you, that person looks just like you and says, I vote and my vote makes a difference, that can be very empowering. So we're doing that throughout the state to spread the message that your vote counts. And in addition to that, sometimes people with disabilities don't vote because they don't really understand the issues. So what we do is we break it down into simple language, and we're not partisan in any way, but we say, this is what this candidate says and this is what this candidate says. Make your decision. Mm-hmm.
Talk to me, because I know, and Justin, maybe you have this information, I believe this spring, so in the summer 2013, the Disability Vote Network launched, and I know by this spring the goal was to sign up about 5,000 voters. So are you able to let me know, either of you, where things stand right now?
Well, as far as the numbers go, Stephanie would be able to answer that question more than I would, but there's multiple reasons. The number population that we're going towards is across the entire state. It's not just people with disabilities, it's also allies of people with disabilities as well. So those that have friends, families, colleagues that have a disability and have want to get to the polls on voting day can help them by giving them a ride or making sure that they have someone to read them the ballots in the machines that are not accessible to people with visual disabilities, and making sure that they are there to assist when necessary, when the poll workers are unable to assist in various ways.
And to add to that, we have about 3,000 voters signed up so far, so we're more than halfway there, and we're always welcoming more people to join our network.
Well, let's go further and look at the issues of concern to people with disabilities in the greater Rochester area. And I want to look at housing first and what's been called a housing crisis for those with disabilities who frequently live on low fixed incomes. A study from the Technical Assistance Collaborative and the Consortium for Citizens with Disabilities found a huge disparity between rental housing costs and the monthly income of a person living on supplemental security income, which is a federal program that pays adults with disabilities a benefit where they have limited income. Mm-hmm. And I would like for you both to break this down for viewers in terms of what this means, because I'm sure some people are watching right now and they're wondering, A, how is housing becoming increasingly unaffordable for people with disabilities, and B, what are their options then?
Justin, you want to take that first?
sure. Well, as far as the supplemental security income issue goes, that is a barrier within itself. It gives the people income to live on, but it caps it at a specific resource level that you're only allowed to have at one given time, which is $2,000 for an individual and $3,000 for a married couple. Those figures have not changed in the last 30 years. There's legislation pending in Congress, both in the House and the Senate, to change that, to increase it to $10,000 for an individual and $20,000 for a married couple. That's part of the issue right there, because if you're saying that I only have a certain amount of money I can have at one given time, and to rent a rental unit or buy a home mm-hmm. is significantly more than that,
right.
I'm stuck in an apartment for the rest of my life, kind of thing is the stigma that is created with that. There are ways to get around that by using what's called a supplemental needs trust or a pooled trust, which is managed by a non-for-profit agency like the Center for Disability Rights has, where you can shelter your income to qualify for public assistance and making sure that you have the necessary resources to live in the community and get the necessary housing that you need. But it's unfortunate the housing is not there in Rochester. There's just not enough.
And it's really frustrating for us because we just don't want accessible housing. It needs to be affordable, and most importantly, it needs to be integrated.
Right.
Because most of the time you see people with disabilities are forced into facilities solely because they can't find a house that doesn't have a step. And I don't want to be forced to live in a nursing facility just because I couldn't find a home in the community. But when you get out and into the community, the only housing that you're really finding that you can live on with your minimal income from Social Security, because you're not allowed to save up mm-hmm. or you'll lose your Social Security, is mm-hmm. housing that's segregated. So you'll see high rises around the city, and those high rises are primarily lived in by people with disabilities. So it's just like being in another institution. When you go into these high rises, right. I have friends who live there. I feel like I'm in an institution the moment I walk in. It's not that warm home feeling. And our community isn't going to be less discriminatory towards people with disabilities if we keep saying people with disabilities live over there and not in our own neighborhoods.
I understand transportation, another major area of concern. And I would guess people would say, we've got the Americans with Disabilities Act. Does that cover a transportation issue? Doesn't that guarantee that certain problems that are occurring are resolved? And the ADA celebrating 25 years in July, but while people say major improvements have been made, I'm also hearing the argument that things are not being fully enacted. So when it comes to transportation, I would guess that, and correct me if I'm wrong, this is an issue that the community should be aware of, elected officials need to know about, because it impacts the community in the long run.
Absolutely.
Yes. With Rochester specifically, downstate they have accessible taxi cabs, which have specific software in the back of the cab, which would allow someone who is blind or has low vision to pay their fare independently without having to depend upon the driver to give them the correct change. There's also devices that would allow the rider to verify that they're getting the right change, like an iBill reader, which tells you the amount of fare. But specifically in Rochester, we have the paratransit system, which is RTS Access, formerly known as Liftline, which I've ridden for 10 years and has made several changes throughout the years, which people who ride RTS Access have not been fully satisfied with. And there's other changes that have been implemented for the good, but they're not fully implemented to the satisfaction of the customers that ride it on a daily basis.
This issue, housing, and many more that we didn't even touch upon that need to be looked into. New York Disability Vote, people can go to that website. I've got that for them so they can learn more and they can sign up. And I want to thank you both, Stephanie Woodward, Justin Young. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
You can learn more about the New York Disability Vote Network and the issues at hand right now. Go to the website, nydvn.org. And this segment was part of WXXI's Move to Include. It's a partnership of WXXI and the Golisano Foundation, working with the community to lead change toward the inclusion of people with intellectual and physical disabilities. And we want to hear your thoughts on what you just heard. Visit movetoinclude.org. Well, writer Rita Mae Brown, she once expressed, "When I got my library card, that's when my life began." And those words really couldn't be more true for some of the residents of the Maplewood neighborhood in the city of Rochester. I recently discovered their library is about much more than just books. It's viewed by some as the family room of the neighborhood, where people work together to help others get a fresh start and to make the American dream come true for fellow patrons. This may look like your typical library, but it certainly doesn't sound like it.
We actually have people who applaud the noise level, saying, "I feel comfortable bringing my child. I don't have to worry about shushing them all the time."
It's loud, but it's loud in a good way. It's loud that there's learning going on and that the kids aren't in here being rowdy, being disruptive. They're in here learning, and they're excited about their learning.
And for some of the kids, it's not just about learning how to solve math problems or getting help on school projects. Children's librarian Marcia Thor says it's also about the basics, learning how to speak and write English.
A lot of refugee families were moving into the neighborhood. They were here, some were here before that, but a big influx happened in 2008 with Burmese, Thai, and Nepali families.
Where are you from?
I come from Bama.
So in 2008, the Maplewood Library responded. It hired literacy aides to work with refugee kids who relocated to the Maplewood neighborhood. Eventually, there was such a demand for services, the library hired more staff. And today, the need continues.
Our latest one is from Somalia, but we don't have anyone who speaks Somalia right now. So it's trying to work our way into giving them the homework help plus the routine, learning the routines here in the library. But we work at it.
My English like not really good because I just arrived here like last year. I get a lot of help from like this library to learn and stuff to get like knowledge and stuff.
So we got to undo the fraction as our deal here. So we're going to leave this out here.
Like my mom says, like she's going to move to like other place. But I said, like, I don't want to move because our library is like important for me.
I'll look in and see what other preschools are kind of, yeah, have transportation and are in the area. And then Nikola.
For literacy aide Josh Quarles, learning a non-native language at Maplewood Library is a two-way street.
Some of the parents would come in, especially around the start of school, and they would have all of the emergency contact paperwork and all that stuff that kind of needed to be done. And it was lots of charades at first, trying to figure out how you would explain your address, your phone number.
You said you wanted 7 school to be the first choice, right?
I started to ask some of the older kids who knew their language and then knew enough English, like, how do you say house? How do you say phone number? And so gradually I would just pick up more and more, and I actually have a notebook of it that I would just jot everything down in.
There's daycare and story time in the mornings.
Good.
homework help, and a teen zone for kids when school lets out.
So you just plug in these and then subtract.
But it's definitely not just young people involved in the library's many programs.
Let's look at this. Jackie, why don't you actually start us off with reading our top here?
For Jackie Pratt, the library's free GED class is giving her that second chance at college dreams and much, much more.
I want to make a homeless shelter for the homeless people out here, and they guarantee to have their bed there. You know, and there I will have a cook on all the time, so they wouldn't have to eat just one time and go to bed hungry. There I have little snacks and stuff, and then I want to open my restaurant up next door to her.
And then there's also the program for adults learning English.
Everyone is all the people.
In addition to a citizenship class.
Just spell me the citizen, please.
C-I-T.
Participants say the benefits are beyond what the casual eye may see.
Good, good, good.
One of my friends said they don't have class like here, and then they don't have to go, just stay home. Sometimes they can get depression, but it's in here very helpful for our feel better, and then we got more English.
Do you have work, sir?
Children's librarian Marsha Thor says they're able to do a lot with a little. The library depends on volunteers and grants for some of its programs, as city funding for Maplewood, like other libraries in the country, remains flat. But rather than focus on the challenges, this family, as they call themselves, chooses to focus on learning and building dreams.
Do you want to build something today?
And they plan to do just that for years to come.
This program is part of American Graduate. Let's make it happen. A public media initiative made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
And this segment was the first in a new Need to Know series called American Graduate Champions. Throughout the year, we'll highlight individuals and organizations making an impact on a student, a classroom, the community, as we join forces to help area kids succeed on the journey from preschool to graduation. To learn more about American Graduate and to nominate your own local American Graduate champion, go to wxxi.org/grad. And that is it for this edition of Need to Know. I'm Helen Biandouni-Hofer. As always, thank you for joining me on Thursdays and throughout the weekend. And thank you for your continued support of news and public affairs programming on WXXI. I'll see you next week.